Okay, shall we start? How are you? Fine? Still alive after this almost 2 days? It's 4 p.m., so the whole conference full of sessions. Thanks for joining my talk. First of all, I apologize for my voice. It sounds like it was a result of the yesterday's party, but in fact, it's more trivial, so still recovering from the infection. So I apologize. I hope I make it through the whole talk, but let's keep on going. How many of you have been to the Capital One session about cybersecurity? Not so many of you. Okay. We went through the similar path, so we also would like to share something of what we did with our system. We had a little bit less, we were a little bit less ambitious, so we didn't want to bring all the logs to analyze the cybersecurity cases, because we also started small. But what we like to show here is also that a small group of people were able to make a little bit of a disruption in that we created an open source the system that consists of open source components that our company also allows us to bring those, to leverage the open source software, encourage even us to contribute to open source to the communities. So it's also maybe that something, if you are just starting that path, that maybe it empowers you to do something the same in your company. So it's also not that often that we share something about security as a bank, yeah. But of course, I would be able to give you as many details as you may want. But there will be some implementation details, how we learned, what we learned on that path, what is working, what is not working. We also started a couple of years ago, so we went through different steps in the maturity of that product. So you're gonna see. So let's start maybe a little bit of business case, because as was even mentioned on the in the keynote, business case first. So whatever you try to do, there are lots of talks about technology, about single components. But first of all, if you have a business case, it's relatively easier to build something on that one. So security breaches, are they common? This is the report from Her Majesty Government from UK. So it shows you clearly that 90% of large organizations were affected by the security breach. 90%. And what is most important for the companies, for the bank especially, what you can lose by that breach? It's not the money itself, it's more indirect, so the reputation, trust. So the fundamental thing of all the business relations is a trust. The main trigger for our system was a Carbona case. It's more specific to the bank, yeah. But you can see that the targets of that attack were employees. So from the vector of attack, but it's usually coming from the employees, yeah, because that's a site that you don't expect those attacks, or they are not your system might not be so well protected from the infection from your own employees' computers. You might even heard about attacks that were coming from the financial regulators, that regulator that was in Poland, yeah, that was an attack that happened in Poland. Yeah. That's how the COINTO was born a couple of years ago. That was this ING Cybercrime Cyber Resilience Program. Three main goals: to prevent, detect, and respond to cyber attacks. A couple of the reasoning, what we would like to do is we would like to prevent those attacks. Obviously, we would like to monitor, would like to baseline the network traffic and do anomaly detection on the network infrastructure. Well, we started a couple of years ago. What was not there at the time? Yeah, the same story that Capital One guy said, that there was really not much on the market at that time. Currently, you've got two open source frameworks, two open source platforms that you can use. It's Apache Spot and Apache Metron. A couple of years back, Apache Metron was Cisco OpenSock. We look at that platform. It looks promising, but to my taste, yeah, it's quite complicated, especially we didn't want to go into storm topologies on maintaining them. Yes, it's now it's easier to manage them through the configuration files, but still, storm topologies. Yeah, and Apache Spot is, you know, Cloudera guys, they decided that, yeah, well, let's build something on our own, yeah? So Hadoop Wars, stage next. There are some also proprietary software that you can use to do this kind of things. Well, they can cost a lot if you try to analyze quite significant amount of data. About ING, Barry on yesterday's sessions said interesting statement that we are a technology company that happens to do something in banking. About me, my name is Krzysztof Adamski, I'm from ING Services Poland. So I'm an ultramarathon runner that happens to do something in technology from time to time. As for ING, I will not go into details too much. You know that brand in Europe. We've got around 50,000 employees. The challenge for our system was that, we operate mostly within Europe, so most of our data is within Europe from the Netherlands, Belgium, Germany here in DiBa, but mostly in Poland as well. So most of the data is here, but we operate globally. Yes? Our commercial, also banking branch is operating globally. So the data that we'd like to capture, we'd like to get into one place to build the system, yeah, we need to capture it from the whole world. So what would be the internet without cat? So for instance, this is my cat that was looking at me when we started this project. Yeah, so you want to capture all of your data in one place, and you want to start this with a small team. Yes, we created a small cross-country team that was based in Poland and in the Netherlands. It was like 8 guys supported with some consultants. Yeah, but with 8 people, and you want to build a system like that. Yeah? So it's like my cat looking at me. But we started, let's say, why not? First of all, you need to ask yourself a couple of questions if you build a system like this. So what kind of data do you need? Where the data is located? How we can potentially capture this kind of data? And the last statement, yeah, what are the legal implications if you would like to use that data? So this is quite important. And the legal implication might be varied between the countries, so pay special attention. So even if you have that data, it doesn't mean that you can process them, that you can use that data. Be careful with that one. So core Intel architecture, yeah, something that you're, that would be an introduction, and then something that for they're looking for. There will be a couple of configuration examples, there will be some drawings, but, well, let's get back, let's go to the demo. You would like to see something like this, yeah? So Swiss knife. So what consultants would like to sell you, that's one single product that can do everything, you can just buy it, we'll implement it in 1 week, everything magically will start to work, yeah. Obviously not. So this is slightly more complicated architecture. It's less complicated than the one that from Metron. And if you start building something like this, you are not going to start using all of this at once, at the same time, in the first place. So you started small. So that's why we didn't want to go with Metron. Figuring out how the whole architecture works, how to implement all the single components, we wanted to start small, and we are gradually increasing our platform with extra components. We'll go into details about those components now and why we did choose those components and what were the implications of that one. So lots of components, every of that one is for the certain purpose. We didn't choose that Kafka because there was nothing else. We did just choose Kafka because we knew there's going to be massive amount of data. We would like to scale out. We want to be sure that we want to capture all of the events. Local collector. The entry point to our system is a local collector. That's how we call it. It's a Kafka. Sometimes it's a single node Kafka. In certain areas when the country has more data located in a particular data center, then we can scale out that Kafka local collector to multiple nodes. We store there various types of data. The amount of types of logs that we would like to ingest, that we would like to use, it will increase over the time. For now, we focused on proxy logs, on NetFlow data, on DNS requests, and some logs from email gateways. How do you want to capture that data into Kafka? Well, there are various things, various tools you can use as well. You can use NiFi if you like that one. We are looking into that to use it. If you want to start simple, you can use syslog. Why not? That's the protocol that every admin knows. Everyone knows how to use it. It's fairly easy to find examples on the web how you can use that one. But how to capture the data from the wires? Yeah, how to capture it from the network itself? Yeah, from the cables. So two things that you can try. There are switches. You can try to configure them to send NetFlow data. This is particularly about NetFlow. Yeah, so you can configure switches to send the NetFlow data. But in fact, in reality, it's much better to tap that traffic. So to put a special device called tap device, and then to capture that data in that way. Then you can use some NetFlow props, NetFlow generators, to not interfere with your network traffic. Because if you really generate massive amount of data, turning this on the switches, you can expect some weird behavior on your on your devices. So tap is something that we recommend based on our experience, and use some NetFlow generators, NetFlow props that you can then use to capture that traffic. If you don't like to lose your data, these are some settings that I would like to point you out to you need to configure. Of course, the replication factor depends on the amount of brokers. We really recommend to have at least 3 brokers, but preferably 4. So if you want to maintain the replication factor at 3, then obviously you need to have 4 brokers or more. Good practices about Kafka cluster, if you want to set them up, is also to have a separate zookeepers, separate from the brokers. So something that you need to keep an eye on. So from local collector to central collector. Central collector is again a Kafka cluster. So since we've got Kafka skills, excuse me, not right now. Since you've got a Kafka local collector and we've got those skills, why not to leverage the skills and also to build the central collector for that data, also on the top of Kafka. Using Kafka, this gives us additional benefits because then we can even survive some dropping of the network. So if we have to stop transmitting the data, we can still use Kafka to replay those messages. So that's why we like Kafka so much. MirrorMaker is a native mechanism that you can use to replicate for disaster recovery of a Kafka cluster, but you can also use it to duplicate the data from one Kafka cluster to another. So time is crucial here. If you would like to, in near real time, as we can say, to capture that data, but business data is even more. So whenever you try to deal something with logs, with capturing logs, pay special attention to not overload your network with your logs. So something that may happen. Yeah? So either you put some QoS or do it in an application settings, but pay attention because that may happen, yeah, to overload your network. On the Kafka side, if you want to rely on pure on configuration on the Kafka side, you can put some bandwidth control there. So these are the two settings that you can use. Of course, if you send the data over the wire, encrypt it. Yeah. So the simple way it is to enable SSL. Preferably, you would like to encrypt the messages itself. Yeah, but then you need to do it on the application side to encrypt all the messages that are coming through the Kafka bus. Okay. So how we did the streaming? Well, it's not real time, maybe. Near real time, yeah, how they say it now, because if you want to go in real time now, you're supposed to use Flink maybe or Storm topologies. With Spark streaming, you can do near real time, but this is enough for us. And we wanted to start simple, yeah, that's what our main principle was. So we use Spark, and Spark is used here for two purposes. One is to send the data to Elasticsearch cluster for immediate analysis. Yeah, so we can through the Kafka using sparse streaming to the Elasticsearch cluster. And then, we'll show you some how we analyze the data lately. And through the matching engine. Some Spark streaming configuration that you can, please take special attention, pay special attention to those configuration details. There's a nice blog post by Martin Kuthan, who explained what kind of settings you really need to fine-tune to be able for Spark streaming to work. There were some issues in the earlier versions of Spark, like 1.4, so hopefully you are not using that old version, that with the Kerberized clusters, the Spark streaming jobs were failing after the Kerberized ticket expired. So this is no longer an issue, but still, HDFS, you need to disable cache on HDFS for those ones. Other tool that you can use, Hazelcast. I don't know if you know in-memory data grid like Hazelcast. It's very simple. The whole ecosystem of tooling is built on the whole platform, in fact. We use only the data grid, in-memory data grid. Why we are using, for what purpose? Basically, because the data that is coming over the wire, like NetFlow data, it's not always having headers, yeah? Don't always having the metadata about this data. It's sending once upon a time. So we need to capture and store the schema. You would like to do it in memory because we need to apply that schema very fast. Yeah, we need to be sure that we are not going to stop our streaming jobs. Yeah, they need to flow fast. So Hazelcast in-memory data grid can be used. It's fairly easy to distribute it, so over the your worker nodes. So your Spark streaming jobs is working on Yarn, so it's distributed. So you need to also to have a distributed grid to be able to leverage the to scale out, because otherwise that's gonna be your bottleneck. This is an example how you can make an RDD from the Hazelcast grid. So it's fairly easy to use it programmatically. We use a Scala job that's leverage Spark streaming. And whenever the new template of NetFlow is changed, then it's the Hazelcast in-memory data grid is updated, and is being used by this Spark streaming job. So TechTail, that library is very powerful. It's distributed. Yeah. Velo bikes, Pass bikes, it's Dutch company. So we've got Orange, and we've got bikes. So how do you find something in these logs? The mysterious matching engine. Also, we want this to be run in memory. We want this to be run in near real time, so it needs to be fast. It needs to be fast, so it has to be in memory. We leverage a little library, Tornado, to load the definitions of attacks. So basically we use indicators of compromise, so definitions how the potential malwares are looking. It is something that is available as an open source. You can also use that from the companies. You can buy those definitions. So it is, as the data are streaming into our platform, we are matching them. If we find something that is described as a malware, if it is, then we've got an alert. Yeah, so simple as that. And the message park library is something that we need to find out a way how to talk with different Python and Scala frameworks. So we have chosen message park. You can use protobuf, whatever you'd like. Okay. So whenever we've got a potential, we've got an alert, so potential hit. So this match that I described before, the alert is being visualized on the dashboard, and then being picked up and analyzed. That's a nice picture. Well, it can show us you can think like it was our struggle with Docker containers. In fact, it is not, but it's about different battle that we face with Elasticsearch cluster. So a little bit about that one. Elasticsearch is a powerful technology. First of all, why we have chosen Elasticsearch? Because our analytics, they would like to search through the logs, obviously. Yeah? Everyone would like to search through the logs. So we need a search engine. If we are talking about a massive amount of logs, you need a distributed search engine, potentially full text search. What do you have on the market? Something on this Lucene-based, you've got either Solr or Elasticsearch. Even at that time, a few years ago, Elasticsearch sounds to be more matured, yeah? More battle-tested, more companies were using Elasticsearch. So let's go and try that one. The other reason was that we didn't have a front-end engineer, so we didn't want to build our own dashboard, yeah, platform. We wanted to leverage Kibana because, yeah, it sounded nice. We tried it out with our analytics, and they said, yeah, that is something that we want. So let's try Elasticsearch. It's fairly easy to install it. Yeah, it's YAML install. You've got RPM. You can untar the package, and then you can install Kibana even the same like Elasticsearch. It's easy to load data to Elasticsearch. It has REST API. It's fairly easy. The problem is when you face the scale. Then it collapses. The first time you're gonna use Elasticsearch, it will collapse. It will hit you. So make sure that you leverage, for example, templates. So it's easy to send data to Elasticsearch, but if you don't, if you are not going to think about the data inside, about the data structure, about the fields they are using, then it's gonna hit you. And the amount of data that is consuming, because the Elasticsearch cluster it exploded in size. If you throw all the logs inside there, yeah, it will explode. Obviously, we weren't able to store everything in there because we're also using the Lambda architecture, which is unpopular nowadays. Yeah, but the original thought was, let's keep only Elasticsearch. Yeah, we're gonna be only our only single source of truth. Let's do not use Hadoop. Use only Elasticsearch. Keep the data forever there. Obviously, the amount of data exploded, and if you want to search something, it has to keep this in memory. Yeah? There are some ways to avoid that one. But basically, you need a massive amount of memory, massive amount of storage. It's not going to serve you well, yeah? To store everything. Use templates. So basically, if you would like to save the data that matches the index, that matches the template, will be saved with that the definition of that field we send into Elasticsearch cluster. So this template, look it up and see how you can use that one. Other settings. So when we started, it was still Elasticsearch 1.4. Now it's Elasticsearch Platform 5, yeah? And it's gonna be 6, hopefully. So those settings weren't default then. Doc values are default nowadays. But it also shows you that down your path, yeah? Don't fall behind with your versions. Upgrade frequently. It's not like with the old proprietary system that with every version of Oracle or SQL Server, then change just a little bit. It changes every week. If every commit, there's lots of changes. So every week the platform is changing. So don't fall behind. Please upgrade frequently. There are some security patches. These platforms are also vulnerable. So please upgrade and upgrade fast, because if you fall so many versions behind, it will be hard for you to follow. So that's one of my recommendation. So doc values are now default, but still pay attention to your fields. If you don't need to analyze the fields, that's one of the terms in Elasticsearch. If you don't really need a full text search capabilities on every of your field, don't do this. Yeah, please don't do this. And if you grow with the cluster, yeah, make sure that if your cluster grows, make sure that you've got proper settings. Yeah, that you're not going to end up with the split brain scenario. It happened to us, because you need to fine tune the Elasticsearch configuration. How many nodes can vault to elect a new master node? So those settings are not safe with the default Elasticsearch configuration. Pay attention to those settings and the other ones. Okay, so as I mentioned, Elasticsearch is not going to store all of our data. It keep us with our data for 30 days. It depends on the index, but most of the data we're keeping there for 30 days. But we need to train our models somewhere, yeah? Because we would like to implement anomaly detection, we would like to train our model somewhere, and we need to would like to keep that data if we need to go back to some incidents that happened before that one. So definitely we need some heavy equipment, we need to store the data somewhere. Capital One guys, they are using S3 block storage. In our case, we are on-premise, so why not to use Hadoop? So yes, we are using Hadoop. That's the, we are reading it directly from Kafka. Another Spark job. We are not doing this so frequently. We are trying to be optimal with the amount of with the file size. Yeah, so keep the files of the size more than a block of HDFS. Yeah, you know the basic principles. They're also saying yet that schema on read. Yeah, that's a on read. That's a paradigm. Yeah, that you should follow. Well, in fact, what we saw is that our analytics, they do not want to build the schema each time they are analyzing the data. And it would be also suboptimal in the amount of data that you really store on your cluster. Also, your Hadoop cluster will explode, yeah, in size. So it turned out that for our case, it would be better to apply the schema, yeah, to use columnar store format like Parquet to efficiently use the space on the cluster, and also to manage the performance of the cluster, so to maintain the performance of the cluster on the good level. It may be different for your cases if you really want to store raw log files, but in our case we really want to give them data with the schema inside. Why Parquet? Why not Org? At that time, Spark was the support for Parquet was better. I believe it still is the default format nowadays. If you want to save the data frame, it's gonna be Parquet. So Org is now also supported, but we decided to go with Parquet, and it works pretty well. Pay attention now, because there's a difference between Spark 2 and Spark 1.6. So you might have some different compatibility issues if you save something with Spark 2 as a Parquet and try to read it with Spark 1.6. That might be the only remark from my side. Of course, he also applies the partitions that you should supposed to use, like with every log, with every logs, yeah, partition by date, obvious things. Offset management in Kafka. We decided to manage our offset manually. We use HDFS as our offset store. It's not something that someone is using very often, but this helps us to reprocess the data. So whenever you would like to reprocess the data, read them once again, it was very helpful in the beginning when we tried with different formats, with different schemas. Then we had to reprocess the data, and we can do this simply by dropping the file from HDFS, and then the data was reprocessed, not from the beginning of the Kafka topic, but from the specific offset. Excuse me. Yep, advanced analytics. So we've got the data stored in Parquet format, so how we can use that data. Different toolset that our data scientists can use. We expose the Spark API. You can even read the data through Kafka. So we also give the possibility for someone that would like to use that system to read the data directly from Kafka. We've got also some unexpected customers of our tool. Network guys also, they were interested in the data. Obviously, the guys having their own local tooling for that one, but they said that, yeah, they really like the Kibana interface, so they like to search through the logs in that way. Well, all the libraries here. We use mostly IPython now, is Jupyter, yeah, notebooks that we use in that case. Job scheduling, so how we train that model, so how the jobs are being scheduled on the cluster. Two choices nowadays. Yeah? If you would like to schedule the jobs, if you don't have a job that is doing this in streaming mode, you can use Askaban or Airflow. In this case, we decided to go with Askaban. For some other project, we are using Airflow. Askaban is fairly easy to run, and we didn't want to schedule in Cron, so just two of the tools that you may look into if you want to schedule some jobs on the cluster. One of the things that Capital One guy also mentioned, monitoring. You need to keep this under control. So basically what we established is that with every source that we connect to our platform, we create a Kafka topic. And you need to keep an eye on the source if the data is flowing. Basically, if the data ends up in Kafka, then you are good, yeah? Because if you have a good configuration of Kafka, you can always reply the messages. But this is something that you really need to keep an eye on. So we use a topic monitoring. Also, this monitoring is being kept in Kafka, and we have some dashboards in Kibana. Yeah? Since we've got that knowledge, you know, not so many people within that team, so we would like to leverage the knowledge that we already have. So we've got Kibana dashboard that's where we're keeping an eye on our system and how it is performing. Yeah. So keep an eye on each particular log source, how the data is flowing, and that's a good practice. Yeah. So once again, something for smart guys. So if they really want to use that data, there's plenty of it that you can use to analyze. Well, terabytes of data, hundreds of terabytes of data that you can analyze. So you can. So they are busy building their analytical models on top of the data. Upcoming challenges from the platform perspective. Yeah, more of that. I'm not a data scientist, so I'm not going to tell you more about this side, but about the operational challenges. Two names that I would like to mention here. This US is not. It's in an early stage, so our vision would be to decouple the computation and the storage pattern, so to create something like if you would like to run a job, then you create a Spark cluster on demand. So this is something like this US. You can help you with that one. But it's in an early stage. We are testing it if that's gonna be good enough or if we can leverage that technology. But also take a look at that one. Remember our struggle with Elasticsearch? We also had some struggles with upgrading that platform. It's also fairly easy to install, fairly easy to upgrade, but you need to upgrade in a certain way, node by node, very tedious operation. So what we'd like to do, we would like to leverage Docker for that one. And so we don't want to do it with vanilla Docker. You can use Kubernetes, or if you are from the Red Hat universe, you can use OpenShift. Even if the origin, the open source version, you can use. Something that we already rolled out. So we've got an Elasticsearch cluster on OpenShift with persistent volumes. Little bit of a hacky way, because we can scale it up on a particular node only. So we've got multiple instances of Elasticsearch. So it's not that handy, but what it gives us quite an easy way to upgrade the cluster. So this would be probably subject of the next talk, how we did it with the NoPHP cluster, but that was an interesting journey, and it helps us to manage the upgrade and to manage the way how we dealing with the Elasticsearch cluster. So OpenShift, something worth looking. If you would like to learn more about OpenShift, there are lots of talks, lots of interesting articles. What we'd like to show is, based on our experience already, this is the nice architecture drawing that helps you to build an enterprise-ready OpenShift platform. So, because you want to keep it also highly available, if you have load balancers in your company, you're supposed to use that one. It will help you three master nodes at least, NFS storage, separate infrastructure node, and application nodes that stuff in the case. Okay. And of course, we are not perfect. Yeah. So what you've seen here, we are constantly improving. And if you would like to help us, obviously, We are welcome. If you say that what we did is totally wrong, you're also welcome. Please share your thoughts. And if you'd like to join us and help us to build this even better platform, yeah. Thank you. Any questions? Go ahead.
Okay, we've been working with Elasticsearch for 5 years.
5 years, huh?
We know that things must be done with, you know, with love. Okay, and day by day love, taking.
You need to hug it, yeah. You need to hug it, you need to polish it, yeah.
This kind of relationship, yeah. That you have to take into account. Okay, apart from that, in the last time we did a proof of concept of OpenShift.
Mm-hmm.
I have really doubts regarding the possibility to have Elasticsearch using persistent volumes in OpenShift. I mean, okay, Elasticsearch likes really a lot having high quality from the speed point of view disks.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and what I see in OpenShift is that persistent volumes mainly are based on networking and enterprise or these
mm-hmm. kind of things. Not in our case, yeah. Go ahead.
The question is regarding the Docker evolution you are thinking about from the point of view of Elasticsearch and Docker and those environments.
Yeah, that's something that also asked Red Hat guys what their what was their vision, yeah, with persistency, with Kubernetes, with OpenShift. Yeah, persistency within Kubernetes is not something that everyone is doing. It's hardly you can find someone that is really recommending this in production. Well, we are brave enough to test that way. We are like 4 months now that this is running, and this is now main cluster nowadays. It's running fine with a little bit of a hack. Yeah, so not NFS. No, you are not want to do NFS if you want performance. We use persistent volumes that are. I mentioned to you that there's a service on a particular node, yeah, of OpenShift cluster. So there's a node, the Docker is there, and we map the volumes from that host. So you are able to scale your Elasticsearch instance, but only on that node. So you are not able to scale to go for the Docker for a persistent volume from another node. No, you are doing it locally on that node.
Yeah,
you need to pay. Yeah, the volume is there. So there's a physical, there's a brick. Yeah, there are local disks there. We've got an atomic host there, and you map that volume from that host. Yeah.
So the problem there arises in the disaster recovery.
Yeah, you need to have kind of a rack awareness then on Elasticsearch. So it creates the replica of your index not on the same host but on a different host. Yeah, and you are able to scale on that host. To the amount of disks that you have, yeah. So one Elasticsearch instance to pinpoint to one disk with certain amount of memory. If you scale it up, another disk is chosen. So there's another instance of Elasticsearch on that host, yeah? and you've got so many Elasticsearch services, as many nodes you have, yeah.
Okay.
This is how it's going.
Thank you.
Go ahead. How we push our logs?
Yes.
Nowadays, most of them are going through syslog, but we are investigating to change it to NiFi, yeah? To use NiFi to ingest the logs.
So you use the version, the enterprise version of syslog, where there is a
custom
producer, because
No, we've got, so it's a custom-made producer. So, but there's a simple producer written in Scala that is listening on a port and saves the data in the format that it's receiving with a syslog header that saves it to the local Kafka. And then we send it to the central Kafka through a mirror maker, and then we are decoding the message from the central Kafka. So nothing fancy on the local Kafka, it just writes what it receives and sends it to the central collector. That's how it works at the moment.
The second one is about data retention on the
system. 30 days for very huge topics, for very huge, no, the, not topics, that indexes is less, yeah, it's like maybe a week for if there's a very large amount of data. But usually the guys, they're not looking into pure NetFlow data, yeah, because the NetFlow is something that is exploding at the moment. For Proxylog, for example, it's 30 days. 30 days for Proxylog, for this type of data, yeah. Data going for the proxy.
One more thing, just to ask. Okay. There are three guys that usually play together, that are Rojas, Elasticsearch and Kibana.
Yeah.
Okay, we have more or less the same project in the company, but we are using Logstash for the
You can use that one as well.
Did you check it or did you think about it?
We are also using Logstash that's writing the data from the central collector to the Elasticsearch. Yeah, then Logstash is being used at the moment. But with NIFO, it's a good visualization of what was happening. Yeah, and the problem with Logstash, what we would also like to implement is a schema registry. It's something that our platform lacks at the moment. We don't have a central schema registry. And we would like maybe to use NiFi, maybe with some Atlas hook, and to register schema over there, or to maybe build something around Kafka. We are not, we haven't decided yet. There is something schema registry. Okay, time is up. But if you have any further questions, just go ahead and you can ask me after the session. Thanks.